Molly's a space engineering and astronautics postgraduate. She works at Oxford Space System, which is a venture capital-backed early-stage space tech business. And appropriately for what we've just been talking about, she successfully completed an aircraft engineering apprenticeship, later joining Cranfield University for a master's in space engineering. So she's going to talk to us today about the SME perspective. A big sun welcome for Shafab.
So, again, my name is Shefali Sharma, and I work on the business side of things at Oxford Space Systems. So, I'm the whole business development. I don't have a title, but that's what I do because I wear multiple caps, and that's the reality of SMEs. Okay. So, I'll do a quick survey, actually. How many of you have heard of Oxford Space Systems? Okay, that's quite good actually. So we were founded in September 2013. We did our seed round with Long Wall Ventures in January 2014, and then we were oversubscribed for our Series A round as well. So we are a growing team of industry experts and very talented graduates like myself. We have a lot of them out there. We've won a number of significant national awards. So what is it we're doing? So we're using origami. I really want to stop fighting these slides. So we're using origami and proprietary materials like carbon fiber composites like that. Did you see that coming? Like these to build our structures. What that means are our structures are lighter, less complex, and lower cost than what's available in the market. We've got multiple collaborative developments going on with companies like Airbus, Thales, UK Space Agency, and others. So these are a few awards we've got. We've got there in the bottom. It's quite funny for me. It's like they want to keep rushing. So there are currently about 2,300 registered satellites orbiting Earth, and I'm sure that number is quite outdated. We're more than that. And this is forecast to treble in the next 5 years. And where is all this growth coming from, or will come from? So you have got companies like SpaceX. They want to build broadband in space using 4,000 satellites. Then you've got Airbus. They want to build a giant satellite network as well, which we just talked about, which people touched upon earlier about this mega constellations. So where are we today? So we've got about 28,000 employees, 11 billion turnover, and 7.5 average annual growth. And by 2030, we want to get to 10% of the global space economy, 100,000 jobs, and we want to make a turnover of 48 billion. That's some ambitious numbers there. Okay, so you may know of this. This is a very bad rocket here, but I'm sure you can appreciate the drawing. We know launch is expensive, and size and weight are the biggest factors there. So people might recognize this video here. Does anybody know what that is? Maybe you want to say it loud? Yeah, Falcon. Yeah. So they are doing reusable rockets, which is much needed, and it'll help drive the cost down for the space industry to launch this hardware. So how we are doing it is to maximize efficiency. We deploy the critical components in orbit. So things like boom systems, solar panels, antennas. So this is full deployment, which is what you're seeing here. And we've got three avenues of technologies we're working on: large unfurlable antennas, boom systems and deployable panels. Just want to point out that for large unfurlable antennas, this is our most audacious development thus far. Reason for that is there are only two vendors in the industry and they both emerged from the US, and I'm sure most of people are aware of that. And just knowing that this technology is being developed right at the doorsteps here in Harville, people should be aware of that, because we will need skill sets who can, from graduates, from experienced engineers who can work on this technology. Okay, we'll skip that. So our innovation stem really from traditional origami techniques combined with new material technologies like carbon fiber, the one we saw earlier. So if you play around with the resin, the sort of the way you cure the final mix, you can get a deployable structure, which is what we saw earlier here. And we launched our very first mission in September 2016 it's a collaborative mission between Algerian Space Agency and UK Space Agency. And if I could just quickly play this video here. So that's essentially a boom system that is being deployed from a 3U CubeSat. Trust me, nobody's pushing it up down there, it's working. And it retracts. And we launched it and we established two industry records. So we've gone from idea all the way to flight in less than 13 months, which is unheard of in space industry. And second record being, it's the world's longest retractable boom system that has ever been deployed from a 3U CubeSat. So we're very, very proud of that. And this is our very first selfie from space. And this is another development for an overseas customer. So what you see here, these guys are very tall. And the structure is about 6 meters. The actual final structure will be about 12 meters long. Right, so this is another hardware, which is the outer ring structure of the antennas we are currently working on. I know I'm currently talking about Oxford Space Systems, but it is for you to know the sort of technology that is being developed in the UK space industry and how you can train the graduates, knowing this is the technology that is being developed. Right, I'll skip over this because I really want to talk about this here. Innovation dilemma, incremental improvement versus disruption. I think it's very important for everyone to understand why we need SMEs and why SMEs do come in and cause disruption in the market. So how many of you know of Nokia? Anybody owns a Nokia today? Really? You? Yeah. They sold one phone last year, so it must be you. Okay. Got that nailed. That's good. So Nokia really monopolized the market, mobile market at one stage. And they were doing really, really well until Apple came in. Apple came in, and do you think, how Nokia would have reacted when Apple came in? Did they really care? No, they didn't. They're just a small fry. They didn't care. They thought Apple didn't have any innovative technology there. But what do we see today? How many of you own Apple phones? That's quite a lot. And what's happened with Nokia? We don't even know of them anymore, do we? Similar sort of thing happened with Kodak. Anybody know of that company? Yeah? So a lot of those things have happened in the past. So what actually happens here is, in terms of this performance and time chart, this is what the customer wants, apparently. So right here, And this is your customer range. You've got high-end customers, you've got low-end customers. Yeah? And then you've got big incumbents, and they start very low in performance. They work with the customers. They keep asking them, so what do you think we should develop? What do you think we should develop? And they make incremental, sustainable improvements. I won't even call that innovation. They make that. Nokia, we just talked about that. And then you've got new entrants like Apple, like Oxford Space Systems, like SpaceX coming in, who end up disrupting the market, which is what that happens. As a result of that, market changes completely. So this is actual sales figure between from Nokia and Apple. You see how Nokia really monopolized the market at one stage. And then you see Apple come in. They had a long time to react to Apple. They didn't care, didn't want to respond, don't think they're a good player. And eventually, look at Apple's sales. People don't even know of Nokia. And a similar phenomenon is happening in the space industry today. And the term point for this is new space versus old space. And it is happening, and I'm sure many people are aware of it. It's just we have not thought about it. Why is it happening? It's happening because we need to change the market. Disruption will happen, and it is happening. So why should graduates head for startups? You know, one way to look at it is, yeah, we want this from graduate and that from graduate, but why should graduates really care about SMEs? So we usually, it's like going on an adventurous sport, like rafting. We are usually headed by an entrepreneur. There's less of a hierarchy. The team is very dynamic, fast-paced, a lot of risk, a lot of volatility you've got there. And there are no passengers on the team. What do I mean by that is you are in charge for your own role. It doesn't mean you won't get any help, you will, but you really have to do it yourself. You have flexibility and multiple responsibilities, and SMEs are able to rapidly pivot to seize new opportunities. I remember when I first joined OSS, it was really a white knuckle ride for me. And the learning curve wasn't really a curve, it was more of a vertical wall, which I'm still climbing. But you start enjoying it along the way, that's the fun part. And you become entrepreneurial, you become creative, you go out, speak to customers, you're always, always, always on the move. And what do startups want from graduates? I'll quickly summarize that here. Practical experience. A lot of people earlier talked about practical experience. What does that mean, really? Do we really want graduates who've got industry experience? No, we don't. If a graduate comes in and you ask them, can you tell the difference between this material here and that material? And they can't even tell you that. How bad is that? I think that's really bad. That's what practical experience means, is to be able to distinguish, let's say, for example, materials. What else practical experience for SMEs, like Oxford Space Systems? Have you worked any part-time jobs? Have you ever started a business and failed? That means a lot to us when we're recruiting. Being proactive, you're on your own. You have to take on roles for yourself. You have to worry about your own career journey, career progression. So you really have to think about a lot of things. And I feel like at university, you're not taught a lot of that. And the reason I touched upon the innovator's dilemma taught earlier is not a lot of people understand what SMEs do, why we need disruption, why disruption happens all of a sudden. And why don't we ever talk about these subjects at university or even school levels? Why aren't we taught what finances look like? Why aren't we taught about business skills? entrepreneurs who are entrepreneurs, are they developed like that? No, they're not. They could be engineers. Universities should be, even school levels, should be motivating young students who have the abilities or capabilities to go out and explore these ideas. We don't do that. I remember when I was at university, all I could hear was, apply for Airbus, apply for Thales. What about other companies out there? Why don't we ever hear of them? You know, we really need to start engaging with SMEs. The supply chain is huge. And trust me, students don't know a lot. And people who do approach us, we really appreciate it. And we even invite them in, look for yourself, see the technology for yourself. See if you want to work in this sector, in this space. So a lot of work does need to be done in those avenues and areas. If I may touch upon one contentious topic, girls. We don't get a lot of girl applications or female applications, applicants. Well, I don't understand why not. I remember when I started this, trying to find a job for myself, I really struggled for a year, but then I was like, you know, I'm going to be reckless. I'm going to be fearless. I have nothing to lose. I called my our CEO up and I said, do you have a job for me? And I remember him just going, he was appalled, you know, how can somebody reach out to somebody like that? And he's like, yeah, all well and good, what's your name? And I was like, yeah, I am that. And they ended up creating a position for me. And we're not taught about these things at school, at universities. And I feel that we have a lot of work to do in those areas. Sorry, it felt like a rant, but I needed to get it out. Yes, so commercial awareness. So you're trying to build something, and you come and find me, and you tell me, okay, you want to buy that motor, it costs £1,000. Okay, have you looked at other options? Have you looked at cheaper options? What is eBay selling? Have you looked at those options? Because we don't have a lot of money, SMEs don't have a lot of money, and students need to be aware of these things. It's like half of the time is spent recalibrating them to the reality, which is not right. So you need to have that commercial acumen, that awareness all the time. Know what you don't know, do your research. I appreciate not everybody knows everything, but try and learn about it. I didn't learn overnight. I didn't have any business acumen. It's only been a year and a half, and I have learned a lot. I've learned a lot working with an SME, and I am pretty sure, I'm convinced today, had I worked for a company like Airbus or Thales, I wouldn't be standing here, and it would have gone down a different route. I'm not saying don't do it, but we should be more like me as well. Getting comfortable with uncertainty. We're not taught that at universities either, or schools. We need to educate graduates of that. Be confident and ambitious. Ambition is huge. When you work for SME, you really need to have a huge ambition for yourself and for the company. You always need to keep reminding yourself, how can you add value to the company while you're working on your goals as well. Interpersonal skills, as everybody touched upon, it's good that to have those all important engineering skills, but at the same time, interpersonal skills, being able to talk politely to your colleagues, being able to translate, you've just spoken to a customer, they've said, okay, we want this. Being able to translate that to your colleagues back at work, it's not an easy job. And then you're doing the same thing back, it's not easy. And being able to communicate in layman's terms is what we should learn as well. We're not taught that at universities either. Right, I'd like to stop here. Many thanks for listening to me again. I'll be happy to take on any questions later on. Okay?
Thank you very much for coming.